Assalamu alaikum.
Greetings and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad, and we are streaming live. If you'd like to participate in today's conversation, please give us a call at 773-434-6625. And as always, brothers and sisters, please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And click the subscribe button on our YouTube page so you can be notified whenever we post a show. Before I introduce our guest today, I would like to, on behalf of Crow Television Productions, the Crow family, of course, the co-founders, acknowledge the passing of former Chicago Alderman and Cook County Commissioner Robert Shaw. He passed away this week at the age of 83. He was an icon, an advocate, and did so much for the black political establishment here throughout Chicago and Cook County, along, of course, with his late brother as well. It's heartbreaking that our brother passed away. However, we will remember him for the works that he's done, the many people that he's helped, educated so many, and a true representation for the black community. He loved his people and he advocated on behalf of his people and showed us how to navigate in politics to do things to help our community. And so may Allah be pleased with him, and we extend our condolences to all of his family, his friends, and those that he touched on his passing. Well, brothers and sisters, with that being said, we'd like to introduce our guest today as a very special brother. He is the Illinois State Representative representing the 10th District. His name is Jawaharial Omar Williams. Welcome to the show, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. You know, it's good to have the opportunity to sit down with you again. I know we were able to talk last time during the campaign.
Yes.
And hey, you were elected, and so you've gone through basically your first year, because you were elected, what, May 2019?
Yeah, well, I was appointed May of 2019.
Okay.
Yes. I was appointed May of 2019. First of all, thank you for having me again. Yes. I really appreciate you all. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I was appointed May of 2019, right. And I won my election March of 2020. Mm-hmm. Right after that, COVID hit,
right.
But you know, it was my birthday's in March, mm-hmm. so it was a great birthday present as well. My birthday's March 13th, March 17th was the election, and I won. So it was a great time for me, just unfortunate time for the world.
Right.
But I was happy, it's great to be a winner.
It was great to be a winner. I know that you couldn't transition in, in the normal circumstances. I'm sure things would have hit the ground running, but in COVID, I'm sure there were some other priorities and some things that were going on. It was a historical class. I know that as far as you coming into it, but how did COVID impact your early transition?
Well, I got to get a little bit of it because I was appointed May, right. May 19th, so you got the remainder of May, mm-hmm. so I got to do the regular General Assembly, right. things, and then we had veto session as well.
Okay.
Then right after when COVID hit, it became very, like nobody knew what to do initially. Yeah. We didn't really have, everyone wasn't Zooming just yet.
Right.
So then once we figured that out, we started doing the Zooming process. And as things got a little better, we masked up and we did do a little bit of going back to Springfield, but we mostly ran our sessions remotely, mm-hmm. on Zoom sessions.
Mm-hmm. For you, been down there, like you said, the needs of the community, the disparities that were highlighted during COVID. Of course, you coming from the community know some of the disparities that already existed. But I think during COVID, a lot of them were magnified, had a lot of media attention. How do you think that impacted you all, down in your legislative sessions?
Well, COVID definitely hurt the black community. I'm pretty sure it hurt every community too. Mm-hmm. But when it's just like everything else throughout the world. And I care about black people, mm-hmm. and working class people. But when you don't have resources and money, COVID really exposed it. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times we were just dealing with a lot of drugs and alcohol on the surfaces,
right,
and a little bit of mental. Mm-hmm. But when it showed, when COVID came, it really exposed our vulnerability that we don't have access to just basic health care.
Right.
You know, we couldn't get access to masks, you know, mm-hmm, and things that we usually take for granted, like hand sanitizers. Mm-hmm. And we didn't get access to it.
Right.
And as you know, when the COVID hit and people were saying that hand sanitizers could become a remedy or just to, mm-hmm, to sanitize your hands, you know, the price of it went up, you know.
Yeah,
it was like almost three, four fold, you know, right, as opposed to used to be, you couldn't, people wouldn't even buy hand sanitizer, you know. But so things like that we couldn't get access to. So we, and just the whole medical disparities from people needing to be in the hospitals and those who can't get in the hospital. The hospitals were, I don't want to say, they were overwhelmed. Yeah. You know, they was full to capacity. So, you know, once hospitals become full to capacity, it's the poor ones that can't get the services they need. Right. Some of the other ones, they have the resources where they can go to the better ones where they have more rooms and more facilities and they got the better care. So it exposed it. It exposed what we know and what we've been knowing. You know, it's just exposed to those who make like they didn't know.
Let me ask you this. For those in our viewing audience, I'm sorry, why don't you tell them where the 10th District, your area is?
Yeah, well, you know, it's going to change now because of the remap, but the area used to cover 10 wards.
Okay.
It's Humble Park, East and West Garfield Park, Wicker Park, River West, and a little area called the Ranch Triangle.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
The Ranch Triangle is...
Where is that?
It's a money area.
It's a money area. Okay. You know, and all right, so of course there's the remapping that's taking place. You all had a busy session.
Yes.
You know. And you know, there's some things that were passed. But I'm gonna ask you about the environment first, you know. Coming in, I know you were appointing and then elected. Now it seems like everything is so politicized between Democrat and Republican. I mean, no matter what, there's no collaboration, compromise. At least it's not portrayed that way in the media. Okay. So it's like an all or nothing. And so being someone relatively new to that field, and I know that your area is very diverse.
Yes.
Your background is very diverse as far as, you know, working with working class people and the unions and having to build collaboration. So I mean, what was it like going into an environment where it appears on the surface that there's not a lot of collaboration?
Well, sometimes it's collaboration, but you know, it's not a lot of it.
Right.
You know, sometimes we actually agree. The Republicans actually agree with us. We agree with them on certain bills that come through.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, the most of the arguments come out in committees.
Okay.
You know, they do the arguments, and once the bill get out of committee, reach to the floor. It's a little bit of debating going on, but it's already been established which way it's going to go anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Republicans, they all right, you know. Sometimes they have some valid points to me.
Yeah.
You know, they make a lot of valid points, and sometimes they is off the wall points too.
Right.
You know, it's the whole, like you say, collaboration. Sometimes
right.
it happens, sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
You know, but it's not where we just generally don't like them, and they just.
Right.
Some of them distinguish, you know.
It just seems like some of the issues are politicized, and I think it's hard with that because I could see a couple of things. I could see, you know, you have to represent the needs and the requests of your constituents, but you could have some opinions. And for me, us in the black community, you know, what it looks like is that, you know, when we get legislation for us or things that impact us, you know, and it's sometimes it's portrayed differently in the media anyway. And so I think those are the things that we're most concerned with. I know that there were things as far as, you know, justice reform, there were things around health care, all kinds of things that, you know, for communities in need, they would seem to be for or to benefit. And we're not going to weigh into the options, pros and cons, or debate all those things. But what I'm saying is that getting legislation, one of the things we say is that, you know, the writing and drafting of legislation is something that, you know, I know, you know, in civics class, we know the anatomy of a bill, how things come into place. But it seems like it takes a lot of work just to get something into committee and that kind of thing.
It does. You know, mm-hmm. what it is who chairs the committee.
Mm-hmm.
The chair of the committee decides what they're going to allow on the floor come through, period.
Yeah.
That's a huge thing, too, if people don't understand. Mm-hmm. The committee person decides if he's going to receive your bill or not,
mm-hmm.
unless the speaker forces right. him to.
Gotcha. Okay.
That's part of it, right? That's the big part right there. And then, you know, once the sitting members of the committee vote on it, mm-hmm. then it moves to the next level and keeps going from there.
Okay. Now, I know that state of Illinois financially was coming out of a time where they didn't really have balanced budgets, and we weren't in a good place when out of the last administration. So I know we're kind of making up for some things. You all were able to pass a budget. What was that process like for you coming to a situation where it was already critical?
Yeah. You know? Well, budget committee is always interesting anyway. Right. You really get to see where all the money goes, mm-hmm. who's owed, and these bonding issues and things of that nature. And I don't sit on that committee. Right. You know, mm-hmm. I don't have enough seniority yet. Right. But Leader Harris, Greg Harris, he does a very good job of trying to help those who want to be engaged learn the process. So I didn't take advantage of it like right. I should. Yeah. But he really does try to get people who want to know the rules, don't know what's going on with the budget, come get involved. Mm-hmm. But we did pass the balanced budget. Right. We our bond rating has increased up. Yeah. So we're somewhat on the right path.
Right.
You know.
Mm-hmm. How as far as the census count and the remapping and things like that, were there any surprises with that, or was it?
Well, the census count isn't out yet exactly, but you know, the law requires us to have a district drawing before right. census map. Mm-hmm. You know, but you know, had I think Trump might have extended the deadline mm-hmm. or pushed it out. So that made us still have to. Mm-hmm. The law requires to draw our maps, I think, by June 30th or something like that.
So you had to do it before you had the actual
numbers. Right. So what I forget what they use exactly, but that's what we had to right. do because the law states it.
Mm-hmm. You know, what on a personal level?
Sure.
Okay, you're here. Was it everything that you thought it would be? I mean, you know, is it fair to assess it because you know part of it was during COVID? I mean.
Well, it's still fair to assess. Yeah. I was there, like I said, you know, I was there. I caught Kerry May of 2019.
Right.
Caught the last 2 weeks of session. Then mm-hmm. I also had some veto sessions right. as well. So, mm-hmm. personally,
yeah.
mm-hmm. it's not what I thought it would be. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. Mm-hmm. Some of it I like, some of it I don't like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wish we had the opportunity to debate bills more.
Yeah.
I wish less bills came to the floor. I wish they died in committees. You know.
Yeah.
I really
yeah.
do. You know.
Yeah.
Because that's how it works. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I enjoy hearing other people's opinions and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. And but it has its ups and downs.
Yeah, you said I think that historically, you know, we think that there's a lot of debate and stuff going on the floor, but a lot of stuff is probably done, you know, just through interactions before you even get out on the floor.
Absolutely. And sometimes though, it's still debated on the floor,
right. mm-hmm.
and sometimes certain bills don't pass on the floor. You know, which is always interesting as well, because people thought they had their bill carried right. or had their bill passed, and then all of a sudden something changes.
Right.
So you really have to pay attention. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? See, you have to get on top of, get in front of mm-hmm. what bills are coming through too for that yeah. for that day of the session or things of that nature. But most bills are negotiated right. or worked from the committees and things right. of that nature. So once you leave the committee, a lot of them are going to pass the floor.
Let me ask you this: you know, as a state representative, you said you had 10 wards. I know that you have to. You know, you interact sometimes with the county commissioners, some of your aldermen, just to, you know, because your responsibilities, you know, just to be aware mm-hmm. of the districts and stuff. How has that been for you, you know, just collaborating with so many people, making sure you just get feedback and touch points?
It's it's interesting as well.
Yeah, because the dynamics have changed.
Right. You know, it's always nice when you have a relationship with people. Sometimes right. people just... You know, people play games. I'm a straight shooter guy. Yeah, right. People play games. Sometimes yeah. people don't want to interact with you. Sometimes right. people don't want to build a positive relationship with you. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people are mad you beat their candidate. Mm-hmm. And but those who want to be engaged with me, I definitely stay engaged with them. And it's a good process. You know, yeah. I tell you what, it was very funny is that Commissioner Deer, Dennis
yes.
Deer,
mm-hmm.
he likes to build a positive team.
Right.
So he.
Yeah.
He interacts with everybody he can, you know, yeah. and Alderman Brian Hopkins, mm-hmm. he's good to me. Of course, Alderman yeah. Barnett, he's yeah. good to me. Yeah. You know, unbelievably yeah. good to me.
Right. Should be.
As I'm talking about time, should be.
Right.
But, you know, so yeah. Alderman Miss is cool with yeah. me. So those who want to help you, man, and right. want to be engaged with you, it's a smooth transition. Some of them don't, you know.
Yeah.
It's funny, like Alderman LaSpada.
Yeah.
Never calls me back. Or he'll call me back and say, hey, man, you know, I got your call. I got your message. I'm going to call you back.
Right, right.
So it's like, he's like, let me call him to say I called him, but I ain't going to call him back.
Yeah.
Other things like that. Yeah. You know?
You know, it's interesting because I know that you were a former president of the Young Democrats.
Yes.
You know, and what's interesting now, I know we're pretty mature in our age, but technically, you know, it's like young people coming in now. So what, I don't want to call it a new guard, but as you have new leadership coming, you're into this next wave. How was being in the Young Democrats, how did that help prepare you for this path, or what was your ascension like, or your path to get here?
Well, it was a great stepping stone. I used to call it politics 101. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a great path. Everybody should go through the path because it's a learning process. And not only that, it's also a relationship builder.
Yeah.
You know, and it shows character, show people who you are, because when you do the Young Democrat stuff, you don't get paid.
Right.
You have to do, but it just, it builds character. It allows you to meet other people too, and to see what other people's agendas are and what direction they're going. Mm-hmm. Some people may become elected, some may not. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just the way things work. You know, everybody's not going to be elected. And I'm not saying that simply because I got elected.
Right.
It's just, even if the process wouldn't have presented itself, I would still have been fine with being involved in Young Democrats Cook County. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed it. I met a lot of great people, a lot of future leaders, you know, and that was cool. So that's how the process worked. But it definitely has prepared me for dealing with some of the shenanigans, as I like to say, shenanigans, and dealing with people who like to hold on to attitudes or negative grudges. Some people move on. Some people hold on to it, you know.
Well, you know, Chicago has a history of that. I mean, if you're here, you're going to see that, a rich history of some of those battles and things like that. And I know sometimes it can get in the way of progress, but sometimes it's like a make sure you battle test it, you know, to prove your point. I want to go to – we have a caller. Take a call.
Sure.
Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Jamil.
Wa alaikum salam, Sister Martha.
And greetings to you, Representative Williams.
Greetings, young lady.
I have Googled your information, and I see you are very connected. I didn't know that you were the stepson of a famous alderman, so it's interesting to see your background. Mm-hmm. How has that information helped you where someone random trying to get into a field or an office position would not have those same credentials and that mentorship? Also, I want to know what your opinion is as far as this crime, carjackings in the area. We had the superintendent of police go to Washington, D.C., requesting funds for additional resources and to help possibly with National Guards and things of that sort. If you can speak on that. And there have been also a lot of peace marches, many of which are going on today, some yesterday. What is your role in that, and is anything in your area that you can speak on? Thank you.
Well, first of all, thank you for calling. Thank you for your question, even though you have like five questions in there. But I'm gonna get to all of them best as I can. But let me share this with you though. As far as I don't want to say this the wrong way, but he isn't my stepdad. It isn't anything step about us. He's just my dad. Mm-hmm. And my mother married 30 years, and he's been my dad all much of my life since I was a young man. Mm-hmm. He's just not my father. He may not be my birth father, but he's my dad. Mm-hmm. I love him to death, so we don't really say step. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times, I'm not saying that to be mean. I just think sometimes people put the step title as a negative connotation, and we don't have that kind of relationship. We always had an outstanding relationship even before he came to Alderman. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And as far as you say you want to get it,
how does it work? A person with your connections, you know, as far as getting in certain office positions, you know.
Sure. Okay, it works the same way. I didn't. He didn't just appoint me something because I'm his son. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like Brother Muhammad was saying. I was part of Young Democrats of Cook County, part of Young Democrats of Illinois. I also was a precinct. I'm still a precinct captain. You know, I'm the state representative of the 10th district. I'm also the precinct captain in the 27th ward and the 22nd precinct, which consists of Drake, 8900 blocks of Drake, Monticello and Central Park. So it's not necessarily, I don't want you to think that he put me here or helped me get in this position simply because I'm his son. That's not the truth. Trust me, he don't operate like that. He wants you have to put your work and your time in. And as far as how can you get involved, find an organization to go get involved with. If you live on the west side and you're interested, come join the 27 War organization. We'll show you the routes and help you out. And it was just like I was saying earlier, he didn't just put me here because I'm his son. I've been involved. I've been engaged, and I'm part of the process. And then I initially wasn't even his first choice for the state representative. So, and I say everyone's not going to be elected or even have the opportunity, but you still should get involved. You just want to serve and help and give back. Come join our organization. We're a very welcoming organization, and maybe even get you a precinct or become an assistant precinct captain. That's how you get. That's how the basis starts right there.
But I think that, you know, sometimes people think, and it may not be Alderman Burnett, but it could be somebody else. Like, oh, okay, well, he's related to him, so you know, they look at that path. However, in the state, in Chicago, Cook County, you inherit those enemies too.
Yeah, you know.
So that collateral damage and that crossfire too. So sometimes, you know, certain things could be good, but you could also have some people coming against you just for that.
Absolutely, you know. But I put the work in. He didn't just thrust me here because I'm his son. I put the work in. I've been involved with the organization since the beginning. Like I said, I'm a precinct captain, so opportunity to present itself, and here I am. But come join the organization. If you want to join ours, great. But you, and we'll show you from the ground level how we do things, how we operate. We're a community-driven organization, and we try to give back and help working-class people as best as we can, and that's how we get involved.
And I will tell you, Sister Marta is very much involved, one of our most consistent callers and workers. So she does the work, and we appreciate her asking the tough questions. Because those are the things that people need to understand and explain, because in your background, you know, coming up, and why I'm mentioning Young Democrats is because I know a lot of people involved in the Young Democrats. And like you said, it's not paid. I know that grind that they go through, you know. And so it, when you talk about paying dues, that's
absolutely
some work.
And but I enjoyed it, man. You know, I honestly say, even when we did have battles against different organizations, different wars, we would come together and make it work. I mean, one of my fondest memories been I was chairman of Young Democrats. Right. County. Okay. Been a chairman is that, you know, we got an opportunity to work for the, we did a concession stand at Soldier Field during the Bears game. And that allowed us to raise our own money, man, for the Young Democrats. And we didn't have to go to the committee men and beg and ask for money. Because at that time, Mr. White was the committee man. And Mr. White don't give you no money, you know.
When you get out there early, you're going to lose your tumble, brother.
So what we did was that we worked the concession stand at the Bears Stadium, and we would split the proceeds. And it was a great time, man. I started having appreciation for not just the Bears organization, because they didn't have to do that.
Right.
But the Bears organization and the Bears fans. Mm-hmm. I mean, we would work the stand. It was usually 5 to 6 of us every game. Mm-hmm. And man, and they would tip very well. And we would split our tips. We split the tips amongst us. And some Sundays, man, we leave with $50-$60 a person. And that's decent little money for. And we also raise funds for the organization.
Right.
So we're getting $500-$600 for the organization, for our game. Yeah. And we would take that money and go to Young Democrats of America events, and we would use that money to pay for a room.
Right.
You know, we shared a room. Right. Probably about 8 of us into that room. But, right. But it was, that's the work I've been putting in. Those things we did not enjoy.
I want to go to make sure we capture a couple more questions, because she was talking about Commissioner Brown. Getting funds for additional resources at the national level, you know, here, you know, there was a city council meeting right before they went, President Biden came here, and then he went down there, and everything is targeted on the guns now, you know. But what's your position, or what do you think about the carjackings, the violence, and then this national help, and then, you know, there was talk even of the National Guard.
Excuse me, I'm not in favor of the National Guard. Let me get to the first part of the question, right? These guns, are out of control. It's because it's so many different reasons why the guns are out of control. A lot of times you have straw purchasers. And you have, and you know, straw purchasers are people who buy guns for other people.
Right.
Sometimes women buy guns for their boyfriends who shouldn't even have been in possession of a gun. Three, and I don't want to point the finger, man. I just think, because you know, when you say lock people up, you know they're going to be locking up.
Right.
I think we have to do a better job, and I don't want to say this may be the answer, but we may have to do a better job of locking these repeat gun offenders up. And I know Chief Judge Evans always says it's still a presumption of innocence. And I get that, but at some point in time, man, you're a convicted felon.
I could see the repeat, but as you stated, any law in the books disproportionately is going to be directed towards our people. It seems that way. Yeah. And by the reverse standard, anything of reform or good that benefits the people is going to be pulled back. We had Congressman Davis on and was telling him that at the national level, you know, as far as people who are supplying these guns, mm-hmm. the people, not necessarily, you know, it's one thing to buy them and give them to somebody who's looking, but the people who are selling them, mm-hmm. you know, bringing them in illegally, you know, over here, man, you know, the train tracks, the carts that used to be over here and things like that, there has to be, just like the RICO things, you know, were applied, the gang things, we got to trace it back. And I know that the manufacturers, you know, could only be so much, but it could be a class action, something to go towards addresses to make it be better checks and balances.
It definitely to be a better mm-hmm. checks and balances. And, but another huge problem, yeah. man, mm-hmm. is I'm sorry, man, Brother Muhammad, is the different state laws.
Yeah.
Right in Indiana, they have gun shows, man, where they can just go across the state line and buy guns from them. They're not really checking. They're not looking for void cars. They, in some cases, don't even ask for IDs.
Right.
It's just, you got the money, they mm-hmm. sell it to you. So now they come from Indiana, bring them guns back over here, mm-hmm. and that's a part of the problem. Yeah. You know, if you really want to grasp it, we got to do it all across the world, mm-hmm. all across the United States at least, yeah. even the world, you know, yeah. but definitely United States, with better federal gun laws, where mom and pop gun shows that used to be fine when nobody made, they were selling like maybe mm-hmm. nice replica guns or right. pretty guns, but now people going across the line. It needs to be better,
yeah,
federally monitored, regulated, period. Right. You know, even from just private owners to private owners.
Right.
From gun shows need to be asked for FOIA cards and IDs and even fingerprint checks, man. And a lot of people don't like fingerprint checks. They make it like it's the invasion of privacy.
Right.
But in some cases, if you're just an advocate or a sportsman, then what's the problem giving the fingerprint up to purchase this gun across state lines?
Let me ask you, though, with, you know, I know the FOIA cards, and I know there was a backup. I don't know if they're picking things back up with the FOIA cards and conceal and carry things. But with so many guns out here, mm-hmm. you know, because even, you know, the legal citizens, you know, like, okay, well, I need a gun to protect myself. But it seems like there's a lot of opportunities to be stealing and getting more guns, you know.
Yeah. You know, I'm a serious with you. I was never a fan of concealed carry.
Right.
Because I always say, and I know people disagree with that, mm-hmm. but I always say that the element of surprise is everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if somebody's out to harm you and he get the ups on you, so now he got two guns.
Yes. Yeah.
It's the element of surprise. Right. You know, but I get the other side of people want to feel protected and protect themselves. I'm not a gun owner.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking about purchasing a gun, man. Yeah. It's kind of, and it's usually, I've never really been scared. And I'm 46 years old now, and I'm nervous. When I was young, man, I never was scared. You know, I'm older, man. I'm kind of nervous.
Yeah.
So I'm not a gun advocate, but I understand people's concerns. It's just that I'm not sure what's going on.
You know, and I think, too, you know, because I'm not a gun owner nor advocate for it, but there used to be a time where you felt there were certain areas you knew how to navigate to avoid things.
Absolutely.
Now it's not like that.
It's not like that at all. Which,
you know,
which caused concern for me.
And that's what it is that things could jump off. However, you know, just because you legally holding one or carrying one, man, you know,
that don't mean
you can still, because it's a better position, any kind of way. So it's something that we have to get a hold of. But I think until it ties back to the manufacturers or the gun show hosts, whatever, you know, that accountability, you know, you're not going to get. Because you can lock up people all day, but somebody else is buying them.
Somebody's buying them.
And that's one of the things. And I think one of the final questions you were talking about were the...
But I'm sorry, but I'm going to tell you nothing, too. Mm-hmm. That's dangerous. They're not even doing a good job of regulating internet sales.
See, I thought it's certain things like that they don't want to even deliver to states and stuff.
Certain states,
right?
Okay. You know, they these guys are smart, man. Everything's right there at disposal, right at their fingertips. Right. Mm-hmm. They smart. They put the time in to commit the crime. They commit on a whole nother level. And some aspects of you have those digital guns.
I heard about that.
3D guns.
Right.
Yeah.
Now I know, you know, people may not see this, but Chris Rock, it was a comedy thing, but he said raise the price of bullets, brother, and ammunition, because. I mean, and that's the thing, the power, you know, when you look at the brother outside of Cook County, shot 64 times? I mean, it's the power of those automatic weapons.
Yeah, that those automatic weapons are dangerous too, but it's also the mentality.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
the mentality too. And but I was funny too, right? I was I went to buy some fireworks for the right for the fourth, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, man, I was talking to the guy working store. I said, man, fireworks are so expensive. Mm-hmm. And he like, yes, because we having a hard time getting gunpowder. I said, really?
Go get that money. Right. They need to reallocate right, the
you
know, for.
You know, so I'm sorry, I want to get back to you know, the rest of your questions about the youth.
Yeah.
The youth, and I think about the young man, the older gentleman, mm-hmm. who these young men who punched on in the High Park area. Mm-hmm. I've been to Leon as a young man several times over there. When Leon was popular back then.
Right.
And I don't know, man. You know, I don't know what to say. You hate to pick on the parents.
Yeah.
And it's the old saying: be careful of the crowd you keep and the company you keep. And what they want was 17 by the 18, and the other was 15.
Right.
And you know, what possessed them to do that? I don't know. You know.
You know, and it's something that you see now. I think that historically, good, strong parenting had more of a shape.
Mm-hmm.
But now with the ability of the outside influences, and your environment can be stronger than your will.
That's right.
You know, as we're talking. So for a parent, it's hard to regulate internet, music, everything coming out. And then the more you regulate, the more you get pushed back, you know. These are, you know, you're taught the climate is different. And I too paused sometime in that situation. So unfortunate. Shouldn't have been doing it in the first place.
Absolutely.
But even in scaring and run away, for the man to have a heart attack right there to die, and those two, their lives are gone.
It's going to be gone.
Before that, you know. Definitely. And I know that one of them had, I think did it before, you know, but all these things are impacting this generation, you know, and it's happening all the time. And, you know, they say that a lot of the young people are doing the carjackings. I know that, you know, the peace marches and things are, you know, hey, you know, if we could get a hold of them earlier and give them viable income and jobs and trades and skills to do that. There has to be something said for discipline, man.
Has to be, man.
And it has to start early again. And I think that we've created a climate of individualism that whatever I want, I can get or have or whatever. And it starts early.
Mm-hmm.
And not just with the children, with the adults.
Yeah.
You know, as well. But I, you know, in these peace marches and things that are out here, especially during the summer, to give our children some things to do. I know some of them are on the west side, you know, with that. But you, your district, and I'll say that even in the second ward, you know, right near downtown, you know, things are happening. We're seeing crimes that happen downtown and around downtown that we haven't had before.
Right.
You know, and so it's everywhere. How do you work across, whether it's the state legislator, the county, the city, on that? Because, you know, I know he's the superintendent, you know, of the city of Chicago, but do you all get to weigh in on that? How does that work?
Well, we don't get to weigh in on what the city does.
Yeah.
We just legislators. We just write laws and change laws. Yeah. That's all we do. We legislate.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We can't tell the mayor what to do. We could.
But she certainly got an opinion to tell y'all what to do.
She's
the federal prosecutor. Yeah, I'll tell you, we're going to go take a break real quick. Okay.
Hold on.
So, let's go ahead.
That's all we do. We legislate. We don't tell the city what to do. But we do try to build a positive relationship with them.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, well, let's take a break, brother.
Sure.
We'll do this. Brother, since we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back on the other side with more conversation. We'll be right back.
Mm-hmm. See you.
Other than the very distinguished Commissioner Robert Shaw. How are you, sir?
It's a pleasure. Good to be back again.
Thank you so much for coming. I have wanted to talk to you for a long time because now it seems that there's a voiceless in the community. When you said that you spoke for the downtrodden and the people, you weren't lying. We miss you terribly, Mr. Shaw.
Well, it's an unfortunate situation that all of the people that are supposed to be the people's representative has laryngitis and can't talk now. So, and they act as though they don't know what they're doing. You know, and that brings in mind the problem with the parking meters in town, for an example.
Yes.
This is the biggest ripoff since Yellow Kid Wow. in Chicago. And then none of the African-American aldermen are speaking up in relationship to this and how it's adversely affecting the African-American community.
There it is.
For example, you got situations here. This company that they gave this 75-year lease not only got a boondog, they allowed to put additional meters in the community. They're just not satisfied with
that $1 billion back out of the
road. Right. And I don't see why the city couldn't have had the money. Now everybody says, the current mayor says there ain't nothing to do about it. And they don't have the money to pay. That's not true. You can float a bond issue tomorrow.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back continuing our conversation with Representative Jawaharial Omar Williams. I know we're about to get into some things about the crime. That's a whole nother show. So what I want to do is we're gonna put a pin in this part. So and we'll just dedicate another show to those conversations. Sure. But for those in our viewing audience who may want to get in touch with you, learn more about you, or just in the 10th district, how would they get in touch with you?
Sure, they can call the office. Mm-hmm. My number is 312-265-1019. Mm-hmm. That's 312-265-1019. Okay. Give us a call. We'd love to chat, see if you need us to come see you. We're an interactive organization, right, man. If you got some complaints, tell me. If it's some state level I can help you with, mm-hmm. I'll help you with. I've been getting most of my phone calls. I've been getting now is helping people get their unemployment benefits.
Right.
I know it's still, I know you still may not believe that people are still fighting to get their unemployment benefits. Mm-hmm. That's what I've been doing. Most of our calls now.
Well, mm-hmm. If you're getting them, tell that number one more time.
312-265-1019.
Okay, brother. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
We'll have you back. Okay. All right. Brothers, we're going to take a break and we're going to come back with another interesting guest. We'll be right back.
Sorry.
The Munir Muhammad Show, a production of Crow. Please take time to join us at Crow, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Crow is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. Crow is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and Crow Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at Crow.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back, and we are joined by another Illinois State Representative. This time representing the 9th District, our Representative Lakesia Collins. How are you, sister?
I'm good today, brother. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
And I want to say congratulations. This is our first time being able to sit down since you were elected. And so I guess the question at hand, we'll start off by telling the people exactly where the 9th District is located. I know it overlaps some things, but just a general proximity.
Yes, my district is very diverse. Mm-hmm. It starts from the west side, North Lawndale, mm-hmm. and then it goes to the near north side by mm-hmm. Cabrini, River North, mm-hmm. and then it touches the tip of Lincoln Park. So I have some of the West Loop area. Right. Very, very diverse.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You and Representative Williams had a diverse area over there.
Yes.
And so, first time elected, how has that experience been for you, first of all?
It's been great. Okay. It had its little challenges here and there, transitioning from an organizer, healthcare worker, into an elected official.
Right.
But it's been a very good, humbling experience.
You know, especially now, and we're going to talk about some of the legislation that you had played a role in session, but we're seeing more people with community organizing backgrounds, you know, come into this process to advocate for people. And, you know, that transition, you know, of what's that like to get into this political forum. So I do want to touch on that, if we can, for a bit. I mean, was it, are you used to, was it resistance? I mean, what was that learning curve like for you?
Well, I'm used to adapting pretty easily, but I had to come to a realization that this is a whole new world that I'm in, and that me advocating on behalf of the community, it never ends, right? Yeah. And so some would say that we legislate and we appropriate, but I also think that we advocate still, because right. we're speaking on behalf of the communities that we represent. Mm-hmm. And so the fighting looks a little bit different from when you're fighting in the community with your boots on the ground, and then when you're in the chamber and you're speaking on behalf of the community. I think for me, what I struggled with just a little bit was getting bills, you know, heard in committee, and then this word compromise, right? Mm-hmm. You know, when you're, you know, fighting against big corporations as an organizer or a healthcare worker, it's a little bit different, because there's like, we could just flip all the tables.
Right.
But when you're a legislator, you know, you have to make sure that the community is doing that part, but you're actually speaking to the policy and creating the policy.
Right.
And it works hand in hand. And so, you know, being a new legislator and trying to build the community to get back actively engaged in that process was a little bit hard for me.
How do you restore the confidence, you know, as an elected official? You know, there's a lot of apathy. You know, we've had, you know, very little change in our communities. And so I know that there was a groundswell of support. I know you had a lot of boots on the ground support. How do you keep that going? To help, you know, help you in your tenure?
I think it starts at the doors, you know, with organizing, you know, I say organizing 101, you take 80%, you know, listening, 20% talking. Mm-hmm. What I heard on the doors is that people didn't want to see their elected officials doing, you know, voting time.
Right.
They wanted to have a relationship throughout the year. Right. And so that's what I'm still doing now, you know, out of session. I'm still knocking on doors. I'm still talking to folks. I'm, you know, having those conversations like, hey, this is what I've been able to do so far on your behalf. What do you want me to do next? Right. And so I think keeping that engagement and then keeping everything that I, you know, campaigned on at the center and then delivering on that as much as possible kind of restores that trust back into our government.
When you say that you've been in there, and I know we talked about legislation, so talk about some of the things you're most proud of, you know.
Yes. So as a single mother of three, around the Runner administration, he dismantled the child care assistance program, which was really devastating for someone like me, because, you know, I don't have a lot of family that, you know, could, you know, get my kids at any moment. I was working two jobs at the time. So it was really hard. And I had someone who could watch my kids that I trust, you know, them with. And so when that program was dismantled, I struggled even harder. Mm-hmm. I even, you know, cut one of the jobs and cut some of my hours, mm-hmm. which meant that I couldn't really afford my rent. I was already struggling because the rent was just too high. So one of my initiatives that I saw through in this General Assembly was to expand access to child care and codify it into law to make sure that, you know, we know JB's going to win again, right? But, you know, any future Rauner administrations can't go below the 200% property level, the federal property level. And so that'll give more access to families. Getting free dental help, dental implants for veterans on the west side of Chicago who are not at active war. And then also getting rid of some of the blight in our communities with these abandoned properties, which is a public safety issue. And that will give access to more local governments to get access to these abandoned properties and make more affordable housing for families in need. And so there's a number of a lot of other things that I've been able to do. But even my colleagues, right, we gave out COVID relief for tenants, landlords, and homeowners. We passed a responsible budget. We got ourselves out of a $100 million debt early, an $80 billion budget that we passed. We were also able to give small businesses tax, you know, relief. And so much more. And so I'm just proud of a lot of the work that we've been able to do in this General Assembly.
How do you go from here? I mean, because coming out to the Ron administration, as I was speaking earlier, we know financially the state wasn't in a good place, you know, in trying to repair that. Your class, you know, coming in, what does that future look like? There's different leadership in the House. This is a start, but as we know, you know, the needs of our communities run deep.
Yes.
You know, and so how do you keep connected to the community and keep advocating and keep building on that to keep the momentum going?
I think as a black woman, a mother of three, who have the everyday lived experience, I tell people all the time that there's 1,000 more Lakeishas out there, 1,000 more Omar Williams out there, right, who understands what it's like to walk the everyday life in a black community. And so it is our community that suffers from lack of funding for education, food deserts in most cases, right? Lack of affordable, you know, housing or mental health services. And I think that, you know, taking that into the General Assembly and being able to speak on those issues firsthand and not advocating on behalf but telling our story is what makes a big difference. And we have a lot of new General Assembly members, young Latinx women, or young white women who are coming in who come from these different spaces, who are just like, we have to do more and we have to look at everything through a lens of our personal lives.
Okay.
So I think that's what make a difference.
I want to ask you something that I asked Representative Williams, you know, coming, you know, out of a contested election, you know, you come in, you're elected.
Yes.
You have a diverse background. You have to build collaborations, of course, at the county and the alderman level and all of that. What has that experience been? I know it could be something, but I know that, you know, there's sometimes sensitive feelings and you're trying to make outreach the best you can. I could tell by your expression, it's just like his. But it's Chicago.
No, I'm
but, you know, it's just part of it. You hope to be like, okay, because we got to work on behalf of the people.
Yes.
Some, at least stay connected to some degree. But what is that experience?
So this is what I will say, right? I ran first it was a 9-way race and then it ended up being a 7-way race. I wasn't running against anyone because it was an open seat.
Yes.
So I think others thought that they were running against each other, but I was running for a seat that was open at that time. And I'm grateful that the people of the 9th district chose me. And so immediately after I won the primary, I was working. I got back into the district. I did whatever I could with the little resources I had to be visible. And then I was appointed when Leader Turner Jr. Stepped down because he was retiring, which gave me a head start at, finishing out that term, which was at a critical time because we were in the midst of a pandemic. We were voting on new leadership. I actually became a part of leadership with the Illinois Legislative Black Caucus as a freshman. And so you know, just trying to build on those relationships, it was a little bit hard. But, you know, I think it's because, you know, some people would think that you would be personal after a race like that. Mm-hmm. But I'm never personal. Mm-hmm. This is about the people. If you're personal, who are you going to hurt? You're not hurting me. You're mm-hmm. hurting the people. And so it's always important for all of us on all levels of government to work together. That way folks can actually see and feel the change that is necessary in the community. If we're just, you know, doing something here on this level and here on this level, that's slow change. If you have the alderman, the state rep, the Senate, and the congressman all working together, and we're putting all our money together, and people are seeing that leadership flowing every day in the community, then it's like, yes, wow, we can see where this is coming from. So it's never personal, and I'm growing good relationships as we speak. So,
and you know, because we were talking earlier about a transition of soul, or you know, newer leaders mm-hmm. coming in, and so you represent that. And one of the things we've talked historically, you know, it's one thing to get in office, but to have the ability, whether it's your team, whether it's yourself, to write the legislation to help people. And so that's something that I think that we, whether it's through, as we talked about, whether it's the young people coming up, the future political science majors out there, to learn, because in order to help our communities, we have to have people that can write legislation. Mm-hmm. And that's something that will, you know, it's needed.
I'm doing it right now. I have some young, you know, activists who are working in my office, who are shadowing me, who I am teaching how to write policy, how to look up and identify the disparities across my district. You know, my staff took these young girls on a tour of the district, and the response, which it will be a documentary soon, but the response was like, oh, wow. Mm-hmm. And I tell people all the time, we have to listen to the youth. Yeah. They see the changes that are happening before their eyes. They actually have, you know, they need to have input on what the future is going to look like for them. Mm-hmm. We're so used to telling young folks what to do and how to do it that we don't take the time to let them be a part of that process and let them give us, you know, what they need to, you know, move forward. And so that's what I'm doing. I've always been a fan of having young folks at the table. Mm-hmm. And so teaching them right now at 15, 14, and 16 is what's going to make them successful moving forward, even if they don't want to go into the legislature. But they can actually have that experience under their belt to say, hey, I know how to write up this policy. Let me help you, because this issue is important, so that when you go in there to that legislator, you don't have to, you know, go through all of this extra stuff. Right. You could just hand it to them. Mm-hmm. And then they just have to believe in it, or they have to have that connection to make sure that it's passed and it's followed through.
Very good to hear you say that, because it's a need at every level.
Yes.
It's a need at every level. And so for those out there who are inspired by your message, or maybe some of your constituents in the 9th District, if they want to get in touch with you to support, give you feedback, whatever, how would they do that?
So they can email me at office@Lakesia, L-A-K-E-S-I-A, Collins, collins.com, or they can call my office at 312-298-9181, or they can follow me on Facebook at State Representative Lakesia Collins, or Instagram, Rep Collins. Okay.
Get that email address one more time. You said office
at Lakesia, L-A-K-E-S-I-A, Collins.com.
Okay. I'm very glad that you had the opportunity to come in today. I wish you success. I've heard some great things about you. And I know that your grassroots campaign and, you know, just working in the community spurred a lot of interest. And so I hope that you can capitalize on that support, keep the community engaged, do some great things for them.
Thank you so much. Okay. I appreciate you.
You're going to come back again, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you so much. Okay. Brothers and sisters, I hope you enjoyed our segment, of course, with the representative of the 9th District, Rep. Lakesia Collins. And, of course, in the earlier segment, representative of the 10th District, Representative Jawaharial Omar Williams. I encourage you to get involved in this process, not just when you're putting your vote in on election day. Stay involved. Contact your representatives. Contact your elected officials. Empower and make them stronger. And more. And then again, make sure that you visit us at Crow, 2435 West 71st Street. Thank you so much for this viewing. I leave you with the greetings of peace and paradise. Assalamu alaikum.